I'm Kaylin Hoffmeister, and welcome to SciShow Space News. Let's start on Mars, where last week the Curiosity rover took its third sample, hopefully scooping up more evidence that there was once abundant liquid water on the planet. Pausing on what looked like sandstone, Curiosity came upon a dark, bumpy, fine-grained rock formation that mission scientists named Wenjana. Wondering what chemical processes would create such a texture, the scientists had the rover drill a 2-centimeter hole into the rock. They're now examining the powdered sample from Curiosity's suite of chemical analysis instruments called the Sample Analysis at Mars, or SAM, to gain insight into how Martian sand deposits apparently turn into sandstone. Because that process usually involves water, and pinpointing the chemistry of the water that created the sandstone might help scientists learn more about the processes that created other landmarks, like Curiosity's ultimate destination, the strange layered mountain known as Mount Sharp. Curiosity has roved over 4 kilometers on its way to Mount Sharp and collected 3 samples. The first 2 were of mudstone, also created by watery conditions. So if this sample indeed turns out to be sandstone, that'll make 3 pretty solid pieces of evidence that Mars once had abundant liquid water. Now, you might have heard buzz recently about a secret space plane that's been circling Earth. And it's not really a secret. The fact that the thing exists definitely isn't a secret. But the precise details of its mission remain unclear. It's called the X-37B Orbital Test Vehicle, and having been launched in December of 2012, it's now been orbiting Earth for more than 500 days, which is nearly twice as long as the engineers thought it would last. The vehicle is a project of the US Air Force, which has taken over the initiative from NASA to develop a new generation of reusable spacecraft. In fact, earlier this year, the X-37 program moved into the same hangar at the Kennedy Space Center where the Space Shuttle program used to operate. Kind of like the shuttle, X-37B launches vertically with the aid of the Atlas V rocket and lands horizontally like a plane. But otherwise, it bears only a superficial resemblance to our beloved shuttles. First of all, X-37B has no crew, and it's less than 9 meters long, with a payload bay about the size of a pickup truck. It has a single engine for propulsion, but otherwise it runs on solar power so it can recharge during flight. And satellite images suggest it has made very few maneuvers on its current mission, so it seems to be running very efficiently. X-37B can also orbit at a lower altitude than the space shuttle did, around 175 kilometers, about half of the shuttle's cruising altitude. So what is it doing up there? There has been debate about whether it could be used as a spy satellite, but the official line from the Air Force is that it's flying to prove that it can fly. We have a lot of experience with reusable craft thanks to the shuttle program, but X-37 can show us how we can pilot craft remotely, and also how long we can keep spacecraft up there. Once the testing phase is over, the Air Force says X-37 orbiters will have many applications, like rendezvousing with satellites and fixing solar arrays. What the military purposes of this vehicle might be, we can only speculate, and we don't like to do that. Finally, I want you to squint really hard at the Segway 1, the faintest galaxy ever detected. It's been described as a fossil from the early universe, but it might be more accurate to say it's a galaxy that just never grew up. Segway 1 isn't all that far away. It's actually orbiting our own galaxy, but it's so dim we can barely see it. It only has about 1,000 stars in it and just 7 that we can actually see. In 2013, astronomers from the Carnegie Institution for Science analyzed 5 of the Segway 1 stars, red dwarfs that are much older and dimmer than our sun. And they found something kind of strange. Segway 1 has fewer metals than any known galaxy. Heavy elements like iron are more than 3,000 times less abundant there than they are in our own galaxy. That's because galaxies build heavy elements as they form more and more generations of stars. Stars form from clouds of gas, and when they reach ignition, the elements from those gases fuse into heavier elements, just as the sun fuses hydrogen into helium. Eventually, stars become so massive that they explode in supernovae, leaving behind clouds of even heavier elements. And the generation that forms after that fuses elements that are heavier still. But because Segway 1 lacks these heavy elements, it suggests that it formed only 1 generation of stars 13 billion years ago and then stopped. Astronomers think the galaxy was just so small, the elements released from the first supernovae didn't create clouds massive enough to form new stars. So Segway 1 is essentially an entire galaxy composed of simple light elements, a window into what all galaxies once looked like when the universe was young. Thank you for watching SciShow Space News, especially to our Subbable subscribers. If you want to help us keep exploring the universe together, go to subbable.com/scishow to learn how you can become a subscriber. And if you want to continue getting smarter with us, go to youtube.com/scishowspace and subscribe.